Hi everyone, this video is going to be a response video made by Spooky Scary Socialist, in which he attempts to respond to his own interpretations of the common criticism of communism and tries to debunk them. Now, the goal of this video is not to provide good arguments for capitalism, but to respond to Spooky Scary Socialist's rebuttals. Enjoy.
If you're a hardline Marxist-Leninist or Rosa backstabbing suck-dem, you already know what it's like to advocate for left-leaning policies on the internet. And by left-leaning, I really mean anything to the left of Reagan. It's just a constant barrage of Venezuela, Animal Farm, and human nature. Just a waterfall of memorized talking points internalized since birth and spat out like the world's wrongest fountain. Even the tamest of tame suck-dems are getting hit with the Venezuela line, which shows just how far right everything has gone.
So we're already at a good start here. The author claims that we have gone so far to the right that even our society sees Reagan as being a centrist, and apparently even the goddess herself, Ocasio-Cortez, is a suck-dem. Well, since the author cannot distinguish between economical and political left and right, and essentially thinks that they are the same, I'm going to have to do a little bit of explaining here. The United States has increased its public spending since President Reagan left office by around 30%. Sure, Trump's corporate tax cuts have shifted the country to the right economically, but it is very minuscule thing compared to the larger picture. Rather than economics, there is also the political discourse, which has dramatically shifted to the left over the past years, and there are many proofs for that. But the author of the video doesn't like talking about it. Instead, what you will see throughout this video is him intentionally equating right-wing economics with right-wing politics, which is two different things, thinking that they're the same and vice versa. I know many people tend to do that, and not just on the left but also on the right, but at least try to distinguish right-wing politics and economics. So no, the premise is not correct. America has shifted both politically and economically to the left, although the economical shift has not been that far compared to the political one.
There is a specific type of person I'm trying to reach, however. It's the type of person that understands that capitalism is flawed, but can't bring themselves to support communism or socialism simply because they've been indoctrinated since birth with the holy lines.
But what about human nature, though?
Yes, we anti-communists are like a cult. We even have our own Bible, apparently. The Anti-Communist Manifesto.
Admittedly, this first argument is more of a misconception than anything else, and surprisingly, it tends to come from people who are new to the left, and, well, sometimes people are just misinformed.
So what socialism means is the government does some things and the private industry does some things, right? So private industry does Coca-Cola, Nike, makes your shoes. Government does other things like your police department, your fire department, your military. So you like the military? Oh, what a socialist you are!
So we're already at the first real rebuttal of the argument that socialism is when the government does stuff. Yes, it seems to be a general consensus among modern people regarding socialism, even though it's not a true definition of socialism. I would tend to say that when the government does stuff is more like a definition of a social democracy or a communist-led socialist country, but let's hear the rebuttal.
No. Just no. Basically, the argument goes that socialism is whenever the government does anything, so everything related to the government is socialist. Following this logic, libraries, welfare, fire departments, garbage removal, streetlights, policemen, the military, the CIA, FBI, and prisons are all socialist. Hopefully everyone can agree libraries are good, but grouping these things with the military, police, and prisons is ridiculous. The police is the same institution that shoots unarmed black men, incarcerates a massive amount of the population, and gets away with murder.
Okay, that's interesting. The socialists apparently don't like the military, police, or prisons now. It seems kind of strange that they were very famous for it in the past, but what do I know? I wonder how the rhetoric of this comrade will shift once he is installed in power.
What is socialism? Well, it's common ownership of the means of production, distribution, and exchange. Related to that is communism, which is a stateless, classless, and moneyless society with common ownership of the means of production.
I agree with those definitions, but I have a question. Does welfare fit under those definitions, or it is only a privilege of the Western capitalist countries? I'm asking it because under the definition of socialism here, it is not about a welfare state that social democrats might think it is. So if you want more wealth redistribution and social programs, don't even call yourself a socialist.
For the sake of streamlining the video, I'll just call any country that advertises itself as communist or socialist as a communist or socialist country, even if it's a bit of an oxymoron considering the definition.
Okay, good. This is a nice way of admitting that Nazi Germany was actually a socialist country. Also, you might as well forget all those definitions of socialism because no country has matched them.
I mean, in fact, Lenin, as soon as he sort of got grips of things, after he said, he moved to what he called state capitalism, which is what it was. It had nothing to do with socialism. Socialism, I mean, you can argue about what, there's no point arguing what the word means, but what it always meant at the core was that producers take control of production, you know, working people take control of production, what's sometimes called industrial democracy. That was the absolute core of it. Well, you know, there was more socialism in Germany, in Western Europe, than there was in Russia. You know, Russia's about the most anti-socialist place you can imagine since 1918. Had wage labor, had super exploitation, had no element of workers' control or involvement or participation. And that's pure, you know, what's it got to do with socialism? It's the exact opposite on every point.
So I guess the new definition of socialism is...
any country that advertises itself as communist or socialist is a communist or socialist country.
Okay, cool, that's fine. Then why would you bother Googling the actual definition?
The image that comes to most people's mind when the communists or socialists talk about wanting more equality is that of a bland, boring dystopia where everyone is forced to be equal. Communism would essentially force everyone to become part of a hive mind, or at least that's how the general idea goes. However, the idea that more equality means suppressing the talented elite to the common level of the masses is just wrong. When communists say we want more equality, they mean freeing the masses so they can unleash their suppressed talents. After the October Revolution, there was a flourishing of art, culture, and creativity. The Futurist movement, legalization of divorce for women, and the growth of cinema were exciting developments compared to the Tsar's regime over the masses of people. It turns out liberating millions of people from the clutches of capital creates an exciting artistic society, not one where everyone is forced to be a hive mind and conform to some incorrect abstract idea of equality.
Yeah, well, it's what you'd like to think, but let's see what actually has happened. The Futurist movement has actually started in the Imperial Russia era, in the so-called Silver Age, as well as other art movements. Even left-wing Wikipedia admits that Futurism has ended shortly after the outbreak of the Russian Revolution. Artists and even scientists soon began to be repressed by the government. Quite ironically, one of Russia's art communities wanted to construct a grand tower to rival that of the Eiffels to commemorate the Russian Revolution, but due to avant-gardism becoming not popular among the Bolshevik elite, the tower was never built. Following that, all art was required to follow the official doctrine of social realism, that by the way was followed in all other socialist/communist countries, not just the Soviet Union. Hence, real art in the Soviet Union went totally underground, producing a genre of Soviet non-conformist art, while the officially approved artists were all grown in test tubes since 1932, or in hive mind dystopia, if you will. With regards to great Soviet cinema, it is only true to an extent. The most famous Soviet cinematographist was Sergei Eisenstein, who did in fact create groundbreaking movies, although totally propagandistic in nature. However, cinema was started in the Imperial Russia and was rapidly growing since then, with just 499 movies made in 1916 alone during war. The success of Russian cinematography was that it was decentralized and privatized, so that many movies could be produced and the market was to decide which movies are good and which are not. The Soviet cinematography was, however, to be approved by official censors and had to be given money to produce by the government, so movies that would go against the official doctrine only began appearing after Gorbachev's glasnost reforms. In the West, people don't know a lot about Russian imperial movies, but they just began appearing 10 years prior to revolution, but if you research it, I can guarantee you that you can find some good gems, those that are in front of your screen. You might also want to check out this historical YouTube video on Russia's art history in the 20th century. The link will be also provided in the description.
Meanwhile, in capitalism, schools prepare students for a lifetime of work, while workers have to become mindless drones in jobs that a majority of them hate. Any sort of excitement or interest is usually reserved for the rich and powerful, while the rest of us go on with our boring lives.
Yeah, and the alienation from work also occurred in the Soviet Union. It is not a capitalist-only phenomenon. There are many factors to that. It doesn't just dumb down to whoever owns the means of production.
People worse off have to deal with the growing ecological disasters that are literally killing them and destroying their homes, while the rich profit off of ignoring any sort of sustainable solution. Maybe all this talk about a communist dystopia is really just an example of capitalism projecting protecting itself?
In the Soviet Union, people have also dealt with ecological disasters such as the Chernobyl, Aral Sea, a shit ton of pollutions and radiations, though they were not done by greedy capitalists, but by a party that supposedly represents the interests of the working class. Now ask yourself, how many of these disasters occurred in the evil capitalist heteronormative patriarchal white supremacist America KKKR?
I've already dealt with the topic of death counts, specifically concerning Stalin, in a previous video. Needless to say, when scholars looked at actual archival evidence released from the Soviet Union, they found that death counts were actually much lower than what was previously estimated.
No more than 3.6 Srontgen. I'm told it's the equivalent of a chest x-ray.
Yeah, no shit, Sherlock. The death of the Soviet Union doesn't start with famine and ends with the doctor's plot. It starts with the Red Terror of Lenin, and we are not even sure when it ends. People claim different numbers, however, recently, due to declassification of Russian documents, it is estimated that just under Stalin, as many as 5.5 million people to 8 million people were murdered, but those are only deaths. It doesn't include people who went through gulags or had to be forcefully relocated from their land. And those are only the numbers if we assume the statistics are correct. Apart from the Soviet Union, there are also other socialist countries who made their own share of deaths.
A lot of the 100 million stuff comes from the big black book of communism, which was deliberately bloated to come to a nice round number.
The number is of course not 100 million, I am willing to conceive it to you, but you cannot deny that it is the highest number of all other ideologies and economical systems that have ever been tried, which surpasses both fascism and capitalism combined. And what if I told you that there was only like 40 million deaths under communism? Are we cool now? Can we test it again?
Methodology for these things is also highly suspect, that sometimes they can go as far as counting someone who stubbed their toe in a communist country another victim of communism.
Yes, stubbed their toe.
Wow, I can't believe communism would do this.
How is it a parallel comparison to the actual tens of millions of people who were murdered in the name of communism? Can you imagine if some neo-Nazi would do the same for the Holocaust, sarcastically showing a slideshow of some communists, mass murderers, and a picture of Joachim Phoenix, for God's sake, therefore justifying what happened?
This conversation about victims of communism, of course, ignores the millions of deaths under capitalism from poverty, hunger, exposure, and imperialist war.
Funny enough, the capitalists didn't systematically killed their own countrymen. In the time of when there were communist countries, of course, those figures are just numbers of people dying from overweight or things like that. As you would say,
stub their toe.
We could do the same for communist countries and get that around 100 bazillion people. Don't you see the hypocrisy here? You judge capitalism by pointing out how people die from overweight or cancer, while at the same time you claim that only a few people died under communism, bitching at historians that they include people who
stubbed their toe in a communist country.
While in actuality you dismiss class, religious, national, and political victims of communism, not only to mention constant hungers under communism such as the Great Leap Forward that has taken away any number between 18 to 45 million people.
George Orwell's Animal Farm has probably done more to poison the discourse on communism than any other book. For those of you not in the loop, Animal Farm is basically a short book with direct comparisons to the Soviet Union using farm animals, eventually showing a devolution to a brutal dictatorship of the pigs, which is totally what Marx was advocating.
Yes.
That there is only one way in which the murderous death agonies of the old society and the bloody birth throes of the new society can be shortened, simplified, and concentrated, and that way is revolutionary terror.
It's annoying to talk about any sort of leftist policy and just get Animal Farm yelled at you, like suddenly these people become experts on socialism in the Soviet Union after reading it. I feel like it's getting to the point that people forget Animal Farm is fiction. It's not a real thing. It completely ignores the material reality that the Soviet Union had to face.
The last and only time I read Animal Farm was probably in around 2017, and yes, it indeed has a few inaccuracies, but generally it represents somewhat an accurate depiction of the Soviet Union at the time.
Namely the invasion of 14 capitalist nations that defined its policy going forward?
Oh yeah, my capitalist invaders that for the most part didn't even engage with the Bolsheviks on Russia's soil, and in some way even helped them, like the Czechoslovak Legion.
He himself had never even visited the US. SSR.
Yeah, I hate those kinds of arguments. Will you now believe every word Solzhenitsyn says because he has gone through gulags? Probably not.
In addition, Orwell himself was a racist and a snitch.
Marx was also a big time racist, especially to the Russians that ironically started the first successful Marxist revolution. Will you throw him out of the window too? I hope so.
If you have criticisms of the Soviet Union or communism and cite The Little Mermaid, sorry to say, but I'm not going to take you seriously.
I don't believe serious people cite the Animal Farm to present the historical period in the Soviet Union. Well, maybe apart from Jordan Peterson, but it captures the transition of power in the Soviet Union fairly well. I would recommend it for reading. So what was the actual argument here, apart from trying to smear George Orwell's authority? Why wouldn't you engage with the actual content of the book? People usually use those arguments because of the Soviet Union, North Korea, and Chinese famines that killed a very large amount of people, with the largest one being anywhere from 18 to 54 million people. Now please tell me, which capitalist Western country had a single famine since World War I that killed at least 1,000 people?
Shockingly, it found the daily per capita calorie supply was actually higher in socialist countries than those of capitalist ones. Contrary to the much proclaimed no food, the average socialist citizen was receiving more food than the capitalist counterparts.
Again, it depends on the year. The CIA has conducted similar studies and it found that people in the Soviet Union consume about the same amount of calories as the United States, yet still lower. Here are the links. But this is not the point that most people are trying to make here. Anyways, people usually talk about food shortages, bread lines, and a lack of choice, with most consumption goods being of a poor quality and not in abundance as in Western capitalist countries.
By the way, the same publication also shows that not only did socialist countries have a higher calorie supply, they also had lower child death rates, higher life expectancy, population per physician, population per nursing person, adult literacy, and secondary education. In fact, the Physical Quality of Life Index, which is a composite and derived measure, shows just how superior socialist countries are to capitalist countries in terms of quality of life.
Yeah, which makes absolute sense, because those countries were included in the category of a capitalist country in order to deceive the audience. But the author likes to be dishonest, so he never mentions it. The Soviet Union, East Germany or Yugoslavia, which are in the middle income categories, should not have been compared to a third world countries such as Iraq, Argentina, Algeria, Brazil, Iran and a few others. But rather East Germany with West Germany, Soviet Union with Finland, or with only countries with similar GDP per capita value like Spain, Greece, Italy and Portugal, with no outliers such as Iraq. Another thing to mention, that I'm surprised that the author isn't self-aware enough to notice, is that there were no socialist countries in the high income category, but most countries in Europe that were communist could have been there if not for socialism.
In the Communist Manifesto, Karl Marx states, "The theory of the communists may be summed up in a single sentence, abolition of private property." Many people have taken this to mean that communists don't want anyone to own anything, even to the point of sharing our toothbrushes communally.
So we already began off by a straw man. Yes and no. Of course, people who say that talk about private property, which can possibly make money like owning a stock, land or a local shop. Although communists also want to take your personal property, like luxury or gold. Only they will call it repatriation. Just like the leftists have a special definition for racism, the communists have a special definition for private property.
Communists don't want to take away your toothbrush or things that you possess. Those are personal property. Private property are things used to make more money and give power to those that own them, like a factory, banks, offices, and infrastructure. The abolition of private property means taking those things from private hands and putting them into the hands of the community. To sum it up, communists don't want to take away your personal property, just the private property of the ruling class.
Yes, so if you would like to invest in stock, trade, set up a Shopify store, sell your art, or open a small digital company, don't even bother if you feel like the communist revolution is near. Those will be taken away immediately. Well, maybe they won't be if you are very close to the ruling communist class elite.
But under communism, wouldn't a janitor be paid the same as a doctor? Doesn't that discourage innovation? Just like every single argument against communism, this one completely misunderstands what it is. What the question misunderstands is that socialism, which was probably what was meant, doesn't mean everyone is paid the same, just that everyone has common ownership of the means of production.
It's not an argument against communism or socialism, but an argument against social democracy and egalitarianism. And this is the first point where I kind of agree with the author, but I'm not sure why it is here.
As for innovation, just ask yourself which country went to space first. Which country industrialized at a rapid pace, turning from a backward semi-feudal country to a world superpower?
What happened in the 1930s industrialization was only unique in the use of violence, but not unique only to a socialist system in terms of an outcome. Japan and Korea have gone through a higher rate of industrialization quite recently, and now even capitalist China undergoes a similar one. In fact, partially, it was due to the previous Imperial Russian industrialization that allowed it to happen, especially in terms of railroad construction that even the almighty Soviet Union's economy couldn't beat. What a shame, considering that Soviet historians treat Russia's pre-Soviet history as some sort of a jungle wasteland where everyone was illiterate, super religious, and enslaved by an evil landlord until the communists freed them from their chains.
If you're looking for innovation in socialist countries, there's plenty there. Historical examples of socialism, like the Soviet Union, have provided free healthcare, education, subsidized housing that foster an environment for learning. On the other hand, capitalism gives you extortionate prices for healthcare, thousands of dollars in student loan debt, and rent payments to your parasitic landlord.
Yeah, totally accurate depiction. Not to mention that all those categories under socialism, although were free, in quotation mark, were less effective and of a low quality than of those Western capitalist counterparts.
Imagine how many possible scientists or visionaries have died before they could achieve anything because they were unlucky enough to be born in a poor family under capitalism.
Imagine how many Russian scientists were suppressed because their work was labeled as idealistic or bourgeoisie. Many Russian scientists had to flee Russia and develop their science in the United States, like Igor Sikorsky and many others.
If it conflicts with profits, capitalism also often ignores and discourages science, like in the case of oil companies denying climate change.
Yeah, China does a very good job at moving to green energy, unlike the West.
Any innovation that does take place is usually for the benefit of the capitalists, not us. Ask yourself why, when a new machine or program that can replace workers gets created, workers get laid off. The answer is that capitalists are calling the shots and want to cut costs to make sure that they can make as much profit as possible. Under socialism, where there's common ownership of the means of production, this type of innovation wouldn't result in layoffs, but rather pay raises and less working hours.
Okay, is there evidence for that?
And I used to say this all the time when people, back when Russia was the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics. And they'd say, oh, but aren't you so glad that you're in America? I said, well, I know a lot of Russian filmmakers. They have a lot more freedom than I have. All they have to do is be careful about criticizing the government. Otherwise, they can do it.
Also get a loan from the government and be government approved, because producing movies on your own and selling them is a form of speculation, which is a form of making money from owning property. Ideally, you would also want to finish the official approved State School of Cinematography, which explains why Soviet movie innovations stopped after Eisenstein, and following innovation was only made by an extraordinary geniuses like Tarkovsky. While in the United States, the social mobility was extraordinarily higher than in the Soviet Union, where you don't even need a degree to become a director, let alone become an actor. So no, socialism is bad.
Communism will never work because of human nature. Humans are too greedy and lazy to do stuff unless we had a monetary incentive like we do in capitalism. Well, let's see. What other incentives could there be besides gaining money and power to get people to do stuff? I don't know, what about survival, bettering another person's life, passion, satisfaction with your work, curiosity, boredom, an output for creativity, necessity, and companionship? What do you think happened before capitalism came about? Did people just sit down in caves and die from hunger because they didn't have any monetary incentive?
There are indeed many incentives for success in life, just like space competition was not for money but rather for prestige. Not everything is done for money, which is a bit ironic considering it comes from a Marxist materialist, so I guess Marxism is destroyed by a Marxist here.
Interestingly, since it's difficult to attack the basic ideas of socialism and communism, like economic democracy and work empowerment, anti-communists have to find another way of shutting these ideas down. You know what I'm talking about. If you like socialism so much, why don't you move to North Korea? Or, if you're a socialist, why do you own an iPhone and a Karl Marx body pillow? Which is such a good way to shut down discussion. The only way to satisfy these people is if you live in a makeshift hut in the woods, but even then they would complain that you're breathing air in a capitalist society. Not to mention that capitalism doesn't make anything, labor does. Capitalism and socialism only determine who has control over the means of production and gets paid.
Sure, we might agree here, except on the part that workers are not getting paid, they do. Also, there is no way of measuring a cost of labor or value of something rather than basing it on voluntary exchange. If you think there is a way of measurement, write it down in the comments. Yeah, I never liked the shoe theory to begin with, since it ignores syncretic practices, but let's see how our Marxist genius rebuttals it.
A common argument against the far left is that, if you think about it, the far left is actually as bad as the far right. I mean, one side advocates social justice and economic equality, while the other side advocates for ethnostates and the subjugation of races of people.
Ethnostates? Subjugation of races of people? What do you think is the far right? Hitler? According to the Political Compass website, a left-leaning institution, by the way, who just published an article smearing Christopher Columbus, indicating that Hitler was on the center in their compass. Margaret Thatcher, on the other hand, is more right-wing than Hitler, but is leftier than Milton Friedman and Friedrich von Hayek. Not only the author equates right-wing economics with right-wing culture or politics, but also doesn't like to mention the fact that far left can also be for the subjugation of different races of people. Such examples include modern China, Stalinism, the Communist Party of Australia, which is an interesting case, and don't even forget about National Bolshevism. Also a fun fact, economical right-wing neoliberals have pushed with immigration to the West, defending it constantly, while the left-wing would usually protest against it until the very recent days.
Fascists suppressed communist parties, labor unions, lowered taxes on the rich, outlawed strikes, privatized state-owned companies, and generally supported business.
Yes, except the fact that communists also banned workers' strikes and had only one big state union, just like the fascists, and sometimes even shot their own workers when they were demonstrating. Hitler perhaps can be culturally or politically far-right, if we define far-right as being about racial supremacy and things like that, but he is sure not a right-wing economically speaking, which is also very important.
This is another reason that fascism and communism are always incorrectly depicted to be two sides of the same coin. In fact, it's the central idea in a bunch of other arguments like communism is always implemented incorrectly, or communism only works on paper.
No, it was authoritarian before that. Marx had a dream of the dictatorship of the proletariat that he wanted to install through a means of revolution. Not admitting that is just plain dishonesty. Later, that dictatorship was represented by the vanguard party of Lenin, another important contributor to Marxism.
The idea that communism is inherently authoritarian is misleading, because it only developed these things after capitalism tried to crush it. In 1918-20, 14 capitalist nations invaded Soviet Russia to overthrow the communists, with the years of the civil war intensifying the Bolshevik siege mentality.
Again, the myth of intervention. Guessing I'll have to do a little bit more of explaining now. The supposed intervention was not coordinated, but it was of many different nations exploiting Russia for their own benefit. The 8,000 United States Expedition Force, commanded by William S. Graves, for instance, pursued the policy of neutrality in this conflict, surprisingly enough, with only goal in mind was to rescue the 40,000 Czechoslovak Legion and make sure that Germany doesn't get Russian weapons in the war. With regards to Britain, it has landed its army under the permission of Trotsky to protect military warehouses from going to Germans. Although the British fought with the Red Army in the Baltic, but only because the Bolsheviks unironically tried to conquer the Baltic states, which they failed at. With regards to the French, they have provided the White Army with ammunition and weaponry, but were not engaged with Bolsheviks in any battles. To put all of this into perspective, here's the number of casualties of the supposed intervents compared to the number of casualties who actually fought in the war. The only somewhat serious force in the intervention was the Czechoslovak Legion, although it made Russia way more harm than good, especially considering the fact that they betrayed the White Russian leader Alexander Kolchak, giving him to the communists at the end, which makes some modern pro-imperial Russians resent the Czechs to this day. The supposed intervents fought for their own interests and not for the interests of Russians to stop communism from destroying their way of life.
The same pattern of imperialist capitalist powers invading to protect capital can be seen in other countries that try to move beyond capitalism. The Spartacist uprising in Germany was suppressed by the Suk Dems with fascist paramilitary forces in 1919. Catalonia was crushed by fascists in the Spanish Civil War in 1939. Cuba in 1961 suffered from an invasion and afterwards decades of terrorism from the US. Chile in 1973, Nicaragua in 1986, the Vietnam and Korean Wars, and so much more.
Yes, because as we know, communism would never crush uprising, only capitalism does it.
The reality is that revolutionary countries are not going to be allowed to develop a socialism that is unhindered. Instead, what we see is a sort of siege socialism, with authoritarian measures being adopted just to fight back the onslaught of the West. In the whole context, we can see that the totalitarianism of communism is not a natural development.
How can it be unnatural when it is literally advocates for constant revolutions, expropriations, and dictatorships of the proletariat? Lenin didn't choose to ban public elections because of evil capitalists who were trying to destroy him, but because he lost them. Marxism is totalitarian both in theory and in practice.
But an unnatural one caused by the constant barrage of capitalist terrorism. So when communist states fail to defend themselves from capitalist massacres and genocides...
Okay, can you provide an example of a Western democracy doing a genocide of the communists? What is even the capitalist terror? Do they terrorize you with constant advertisements and subscriptions to fucking OnlyFans webpages or try to take away your property? Oh, wait a minute.
But when communist states do defend themselves, when they implement strict security measures to protect their people from capitalist death squads, then the capitalists run crying, decrying the commies for being power-hungry monsters who were just a forward-tarian seeking to seize state power all along.
Yes, it's not that communists killed their political opponents and those who may threaten their dominance over the state. I guess, according to that logic, all violence is justified for you if it means securing the current political control.
So if communism is bad and weak when it fails to defend itself, but is also bad and authoritarian when it does defend itself, then when would communism ever not be depicted to be villainous? The answer is never, because no matter what communist states do, it's always spun to be bad.
Yes.
This argument goes hand in hand with the totalitarian one before. The idea goes that communist governments are oppressive and that the poor and downtrodden are prevented from exercising the democratic rights they had before. The truth, however, is much less dramatic. Democratic rights hadn't existed in these countries before communism arrived. Poland was a rightist dictatorship. Russia was a czarist autocracy.
Freedom of speech secured women's right to vote and had their own parliament.
Albania was an Italian fascist protectorate. Cuba was a US-sponsored dictatorship. Lithuania, Hungary, and Romania were all fascist regimes. These countries had known little democracy.
Moreover, I'm pretty sure the regimes in those countries you listed were better off in terms of political rights than communist ones, especially when it comes to elections.
If you're actually curious about democracies under communism, check out this video detailing how Cuba's democratic system works. Needless to say, it's much better than the system we have in capitalist countries.
Was it just irony or lack of self-awareness? Which one? I think it's the latter.
So while capitalists are willing to virtue signal political rights and liberties in communist countries, they will brutally crush it if the people actually support the communist regimes. Before the dissolution of the Soviet Union, the people held a referendum in which the vast majority of people wished to preserve the Union. Of course, the political will of the people should be ignored if it goes against capital's interests, and went ahead anyway.
So I guess instead of rebuttaling this argument, which you obviously can't do, you just changed the topic completely. Okay then.
If you want to discuss political rights being taken away in communist countries, there's no better time than during the overthrow of communism. Yeltsin, the US-supported capitalist president of Russia, disbanded the Russian parliament along with every other elected represented body, abolished Russia's constitutional court, banned labor unions from political activities, outlawed parties, and attacked the parliament building, killing 2,000 people. Yeltsin's popularity rating right before the election of 1996 was 8%.
Although I don't agree with Yeltsin entirely, but you have just admitted that resorting to violence for the sake of securing the political control is fine. So what is your problem then? Oh, You like it when the communists do it, but not when the capitalists. Okay then.
Wow. Look at that. Breadlines for the hungry people under communism. How shameful. This is obviously proof that communism doesn't... Wait a second. These are pictures from the Great Depression. A failure stemming from capitalism, not communism.
Yes, breadlines in the capitalist countries existed under a condition of a market failure, while the breadlines in the communist countries existed at all times. We'll look at the breadlines of the Great Depression with shock, while we look at socialist breadlines as the default state of being.
Many countries were faced with decades of maldevelopment and exploitation when communism arrived. The devastation of war meant widespread poverty and misery in Eastern Europe, China, and Russia. Communism rebuilt these countries from the bottom up, leaving them in much better shape than when they found them.
Then why was Germany better off than East Germany? Why South Korea is better than North Korea? Despite the fact that North Korea got a very good start and was constantly sucking off its two sugar daddies, being China and the USSR.
Inflation increased, consumer spending decreased by 38% in Russia, poverty and homelessness was commonplace, death rates from suicide, illness, and infant mortality increased, security for workers became essentially non-existent, and unemployment rates went as high as 30%.
Of course, dismantling an entire economic system would result in a long crisis, but there were countries who recovered very fast from it and even benefited from capitalism tremendously, like the Baltic states, Czechia, former East Germany, Slovenia, Slovakia, Poland, and many more.
The transition to capitalism and free markets will obviously have a period of hardship, but it's only temporary until economic prosperity magically appears.
Finally, what else can I show you to prove my point rather than the progress of Chinese economy and the quality of life after it has turned capitalist?
It is true that the fall of communism in the Soviet Union and Eastern Europe was a triumph for capitalism, but that happened over a quarter of a century ago. Let's see what's happened since. Since the collapse of communism, the United States and capitalist powers have attacked and even outright invaded various countries like Iraq, Yugoslavia, Afghanistan, Iraq again, Libya, and the smaller interventions in between. The social democracy in Scandinavia you all love? The main reason it's so strong is because communism was literally around the corner.
Do you have evidence that this is why they turned social democracies while other neighboring countries didn't?
Without communism to blunt the edges of capital, capitalists have been free to exploit workers and are continually rolling back rights.
Rolling back rights? Can you provide a specific example for that?
Communism did work. It provided essential services like healthcare, education for free, full employment, rough income inequality, and inexpensive housing with a reliably growing economy.
Okay, you just want to repeat all of your talking points once more. That's fine. By the way, many of that is provided by the capitalist France, Germany, capitalist Scandinavia. Although it's called a welfare state, in any event, you don't need socialism for that.
The only reason communism in the Soviet Union collapsed is the West's efforts to bring it down. The strains of the Cold War with a punishing amount of its GDP spent on military, the cost of being an anchor to other socialist countries and movements, Gorbachev's awful policy failures, and a coup d'etat led by Pizza Hut.
Well, I thought it failed because of the aftermath of the Afghan war, prices of oil going down, dysfunctional economy, and the outcomes of the Glasnost reforms that allowed communists to get destroyed by facts and logic, or be in competition with other ideologies that had better arguments of what to do. But apparently I'm wrong because the history is written by winners or something. By the way, a detailed explanation of why it's failed can be found in any historical book, but I'll just cite my favorite one. It's pretty short and worth reading. It doesn't include all of the factors I mentioned, however, but you can take a look at it nevertheless. So why you didn't include those explanations?
None of these reasons have anything to do with communism itself. On the contrary, it proves that capitalism doesn't work because of how far capitalists will go to crush any attempts at communism. As former GDR Minister Heinz Kessler said, sure, I heard about the new freedom that people are enjoying in Eastern Europe, but how do you define freedom? Millions of people in Eastern Europe are now free from employment, free from safe streets, free from healthcare, free from social security.
At least now they are free to have private property and say what they want to say. Well, maybe not until the very recent years, but this is a story for another day.
Modern-day communists are often stereotyped as lazy, good-for-nothing, white college students who want nothing to do with their lives. Of course, this is all nonsense. Communists can come from any and all backgrounds, and are usually from the most marginalized groups.
Marginalized groups? You mean the
In fact, now a majority of Russians actually prefer the return of socialism and the Soviet Union after all this time.
Here's a more recent poll where 28% of people would actually like it to be returned. Also, another reason behind why Soviet nostalgia is popular in Russia is because it is not only associated with socialism or communism with the common people, but also with the days when Russia was stronger and bigger than it is now. I bet many people would say the same about it if, let's say, the Soviet Union didn't collapse in 1991, but the Russian Empire did.
Another poll says that, reflecting back on the breakup of the Soviet Union that happened 22 years ago next week, residents in 7 out of 11 countries that are part of the Union are more likely to believe its collapse harmed their countries than benefited.
Out of 11? But strangely enough, the Soviet Union was comprised of 15 different countries, not 11. I wonder why the other 4 were not included in your study.
Here's another poll that shows the majority of former East Germans actually feel life was better under communism.
Yeah, I like how the author never mentions his sources. All I could find about it was those 2 interesting articles, which I do recommend reading, but it doesn't show that East Germans felt better under the communist rule.
Another that shows a whopping 72% of Hungarians say that they are worse off under capitalism. And another that shows that many Czechs say they had a better life under communism. And here's another that shows the majority of Serbs say life was better under Tito. Okay, you get the point. Country after country, you see large amounts of people, and usually majorities.
It's a common effect. In almost every other country, regardless of ex-communist or capitalist, as was admitted in the article that you didn't cite, it was conducted right after the end of the financial crisis. But here is a newer poll that supports the opposite conclusion. For example, 85 of young Slovaks approved the movement to a capitalist economy, compared to those who are over 60, with support being of 49%, which is likely due to a communist indoctrination and communist control over the production of culture for the period of about 50 years. In the same poll, 56% of Hungarians indicate that economic situation changed for the better after communism, compared to 31% who felt otherwise. Why you didn't mention all of that, but instead went to a research conducted after the economical crisis of 2008?
I often get told in the comment section of videos that I'm biased and stuck in my own bubble. And let me just say that you're right. But the thing about bias is that it doesn't really mean anything because everyone skews everything to their own perspective.
Yes, what an absolute load of crap.
Buffy detected. Initiating speed round debunking.
After that, the author made some mockeries of the victims of communism, ending with memes glorifying Stalin, so I had to skip it.
Have you ever considered Vuvuzela?
There it is, the elephant in the room. I've avoided talking at length about specific countries for this video because I simply can't cover all of them and I would get a lot of comments saying I forgot to include this country or the other. But Venezuela is pretty much something that anyone to the left of Joseph McCarthy has heard, and I do mean it, so I'll make an exception this time. Now, why is Venezuela in such a bad place? Is it because of socialism? No. Venezuela funds public programs by relying on the money it makes on oil. When the price of oil collapsed, that meant a lot of its funds for these things did as well. So the root cause of Venezuela's financial struggles has to do with the sudden collapse of oil prices, a staple of capitalist markets.
Yes, oil, but you failed to mention that Hugo Chavez's regime became strengthened also because oil.
Chaos, hunger, and strife is inevitable when you're the target of American imperialism. And despite this economic chaos, the people of Venezuela still support the Bolivarian Revolution, Chavez, and the democratically elected Maduro over the US-backed attempted coup. In fact, they probably support it more now because the US is starving and attacking them.
They do, if you assume the election wasn't rigged in favor of the dictator.
The problem is that with Venezuela being America's number one target right now, the corporate media is working overtime to try and print a lot of misinformation. Like for example, when a news story broke out about Venezuelans burning aid, it was immediately called out as fake by people with a strange ability called critical thinking. It wasn't until weeks later that the failing New York Times finally published a piece revealing that, yes, the footage probably wasn't real.
But Maduro is still a dictator, guys. Please listen to us.
The footage might not be real, but here is what's real. 78% of Venezuelans struggle with getting food, 80% struggle with paying medical and healthcare, and 86% with buying clothing needed for family. Probably for the reasons that you failed to debunk and reasons that you didn't include, but let's hear what you have to say.
It's easy to debunk all these arguments, but we'll never get anywhere unless we examine why anti-communism is so prolific. Communism, first and foremost, is a threat to property owners, so ruling interests have made sure to pound anti-communist doctrine into our heads for literally centuries.
Yes, those evil property owners self-organize and actively engage in deception of the poor proletariat, subjecting them to live under capitalism to profit off of them. And this is why you, dear comrades, don't find the ideas of communism convincing.
I gave a little snippet of this idea earlier, but a full explanation is given by Michael Prenti in Black Shirts and Reds. In the United States, for over 100 years, the ruling interests tirelessly propagated anti-communism among the populace, until it became more like a religious orthodoxy than a political analysis. During the Cold War, the anti-communist ideological framework could transform any data about existing communist societies into hostile evidence. If the Soviets refused to negotiate a point, they were intransigent and belligerent. If they appeared to be willing to make concessions, this was but a skillful ploy to put us off our guard. By opposing arms limitations, they would have demonstrated their aggressive intent, but when in fact they supported most armament treaties, it was because they were mendacious and manipulative. If the churches in the USSR were empty, this demonstrated that religion was suppressed, but if the churches were full, this meant that people were rejecting the regime's atheistic ideology. If the workers went on strike, as happened on infrequent occasions, this was evidence of their alienation from the collectivist system. But if they didn't go on strike, this was because they were intimidated and lacked freedom.
Yet similar things were said in the USSR about evil American imperialism, interpreting everything America does as bad.
In this sense, anti-communism is not really a position to take, but rather an unfalsifiable religious doctrine. And as we know, anything that can't be proven false isn't scientific.
And as we know, Karl Popper, who introduced the concept of falsifiability, went to the example of the Marxist doctrine with its laws of dialectics and historical methods so that it could serve as an example of a non-falsifiable proposition alongside Freudism. Here's what actually Karl Popper had to say about it.
The Marxist theory of history, in spite of the serious efforts of some of its founders and followers, ultimately adopted this soothsaying practice in some of its earlier formulations. For example, in Marx's analysis of the character of the coming social revolution, their predictions were testable, and in fact falsified. Yet instead of accepting the refutations, the followers of Marx reinterpreted both the theory and the evidence in order to make them agree. In this way, they rescued the theory from refutation, but they did so at the price of adopting a device which made it irrefutable. They thus gave a conventionalist twist to the theory, and by this stratagem they destroyed its much-advertised claim to scientific status.
Capitalist realism, as Fisher describes, is the sense that not only is capitalism the only viable political and economic system, but that it is impossible to even imagine an alternative to it. As the phrase goes, it's easier to imagine the end of the world than it is to imagine the end of capitalism.
Yeah, very ethnocentric of you, because many people have lived under it, but you mocked their experiences in the previous talking point, so whatever.
Sure, capitalism may spread poverty, famine, and war, but isn't that just reality?
Capitalism doesn't contribute to poverty, famine, and war. At least capitalist democracies have so much economic ties to each other, going to war is not going to be economically beneficial for any of them. Besides, as the world continues to be more capitalistic, the number of people in extreme poverty reduces. As well, as I said before, there are no famines under modern Western capitalism, contrary to what would happen under communism. Ah, it's bad. The arguments against communism that the author has selectively chose in order to quote-unquote rebuttal them were pretty weak, but nevertheless he still failed to adequately respond to them. Sometimes even saying shit like, "But what about the capitalists?" as well as mocking the victims of communism and changing topics. I think I have showed you enough of his lies, biases, and hypocrisies. Even if you go to Wikipedia, you can see a lot of different criticisms of both the Marxist theory and the communist rule that include many things that were not presented under the video. Such criticisms of communist party rules that were not mentioned include criticisms of their environmental policy, criticisms of state plans, criticisms of the economy, criticisms of artistic, scientific, and technological policies, social development, support for terrorism, mass killings, imperialism, lack of freedom of movement, lack of other political freedoms, very hierarchical power structure and corruption, human rights violation, personality cults. Now, the criticisms of Marxist theory that were not included include its unfalsifiability, vague interpretations that arise from the theory, historical materialism, historical determinism, the labor theory of value, disordered or absent price signals, reduced incentives, criticism of Marxian social analysis, and general inconsistency. Those criticisms were mostly taken from Wikipedia, and practically none of them were really addressed in the video, which makes me think that he only picked strawman arguments but couldn't even address them properly anyways. I guess to his defense I can only say that he appealed to the lowest common denominator, but I believe that even they can point more criticism of socialism and not scream like want equal pay, discourage innovation, or what about human nature though, and think that they wanna debate. The video was more of an attempt to spew Marxist propaganda points rather than to actually address the criticisms of Marxism, but if you look at any polling data in an ex-communist country, it will be crystal clear for you that people are moving towards capitalism. It is not 19th or 20th century anymore. People and the economy has changed. It matters less who produces goods, but more who buys them. This is a reality of the 21st century, and for the realities of the 21st century, we need an economical and political approaches that will be up to date with our current time. And those were all my words for today. Thank you for watching.